again, and I'd like to thank Bernard for the kind invitation to come talk to you again this year. So, today I'm going to be talking about human attention and exosomatization. And what I want to do really is to think about the specific constellations of technologies and practices that are being constructed, built, made, in order to facilitate certain forms of attention. Now, thinking particularly about attention here, because it's an interesting kind of case of the way in which these infrastructures are put together, but also I think it's useful as a kind of nexus for thinking about how new modes of knowing and new structures of organising and classifying, driven particularly by computation, of course, are connected together and connected with the notion of, for example, big data, machine learning, and so on and so forth. This is part of a project that we're developing at the Sussex Humanities Lab. My colleague Beatrice Varzi is here somewhere in the audience, and we've got some other colleagues as well, where we're developing a research program around this work. So it's very much a tentative presentation, and it's about raising the questions of attention, the capacity to pay attention, what does attention mean in a computational digital age. And also it's an experiment in thinking through the problem of attention via the categories of exosomatization and endosomatization, which of course Bernard has been deploying, I think, quite interestingly in his work. The other conceptual and technical issue that is driven by this research is the question of new forms of what we might call machinery, computational techniques, computational infrastructures, if you like, combined with new forms of representation, new forms of visualization, new forms of interface. And here I'm thinking particularly of the notion of real-time streams. So real-time streams are the form that we're increasingly becoming comfortable with. We use to select our television programs in Netflix and Amazon Prime, for example. We use them to organize our news structures. So it's very much the form of a Facebook news feed, for example, and of Twitter. And also of our life itself, the notion of a live stream, so that we are able to review rather large quantities of information or manage large quantities of information by this new kind of temporal interface, which I think is very interesting, and it's very interesting to see how it then comes to structure data and knowledge itself. So of course, as we know, there is a kind of political economy to these issues as well, although I won't be speaking to that particularly today, because of the limitation of time. We do, of course, need to always be attentive to these kinds of issues. And the contestation over what we might call the capture of attention, we're thinking here, of course, of Facebook and Twitter and the other captivating technologies that use certain kinds of interface design in order to essentially not just capture attention, but also commoditize it as well. And here, of course, it's quite useful to refer to Dallas Smythe's work on the attention commodity, although, again, I won't be particularly focusing on these kinds of issues in this talk. So, to think about this new flow of information, this new representational form of information, requires us really to sort of begin to think about new categories, to think about new concepts, I think. And these interfaces are, in some sense, a response to a problematic. The problematic is one of large quantities of data, or big data, as it tends to be known, new techniques of organizing and structuring this data through data science, for example, new and often very massive archives, huge quantities of information that become available to us, not just in terms of library archives and national archives, but of course the web itself is a huge and growing archive, and the archive cloud as well, so we increasingly produce huge amounts of data ourselves. We're in a sense have a new kind of technology of the self, in as much as we self-archive continuously. My students, when I question them, have gigabytes of photographs of memories, which of course they never review. They're kind of a latent tertiary form of memory, as it were. But nonetheless, this kind of comprehensive, collective sense of the kind of subject of digital capitalism is very interesting in and of itself. Of course, we're not just consciously collecting data. The devices that surround us, the infrastructures, are also surreptitiously collecting very large quantities of data. All our mobile phones are continuously archiving our located position. Some of the mobile devices and some of the browser interfaces are collecting our clicks and likes, and even the fragments of mistakes and non-posted information. Facebook famously has an interest in why we don't post information to our feeds. So it monitors not just what you send, but what you think about sending, i.e. what you start to write and then delete. And also how you hover the cursor around on the browser page, for example. So there's huge amounts of data that are continuously being collected. And of course, not only does this raise a problematic for the subject of the digital age, as it were, but also for organisations and corporations which have to deal with rather large capacity of information. And of course, that comes to the question that I'm thinking about today, which is one of attention itself. How does one select or filter or curate or focus on particular aspects of data? How does one draw from a very large data set or archive or flow of information and make a selection and focus on that selection? What are the capacities? How does one build those capacities? And of course, that's a historical question as well as a kind of technical question. But also questions of social attention as well, not just the question of the subject, but the question of what do we pay attention to as a public, I think, is an interesting question. Of course, with the election of Trump, for example, there's been a lot of discussion of fake news and how fake news has been an artifact of certain kinds of algorithmic processes, particularly on Facebook. But nonetheless, these Facebook algorithms are built around presenting to us things that captivate our attention. So attention itself, I think, is a very interesting way of thinking about some of these cognitive technologies, these exosomatizations, perhaps. Attention, of course, historically has been a very important issue. We, of course, have a really rich history of discussions of various forms of how one develops the kinds of capacities to be able to be active in certain kinds of society. So, for example, everyone might think of the way in which attention is required to be active in a public sense, a Kantian sense perhaps. So the notion of the public use of reason insinuates an attentional capacity, in the private use of reason to make selections, to be able to decide or to curate one's own reading and writing, but also the capacity to pay attention to the res publica, to public things, and to be able to use reason through that attentional curation, attentional selection, to develop a social epistemology, if you like, a sense of what is important to a public, to a political or literate public. So we can certainly agree with Stiegler that the capacity of attention is both a psychic and a social faculty. I think that's a very important aspect of ways of thinking about the question of attention, the way in which what we might call attentional exosomatization. is deployed. And I think actually, and of course this is in some sense speculative, but I think that the requirements for a psychic and a social faculty would require different kinds of technology. I don't think necessarily one scales from a psychic capacity to capture the attention of the subject and you know, somehow a social attention appears. I think these are probably different kinds of deployment or different kinds of constellation that's required in order to create this faculty. And so this is really addressing and thinking about this kind of question in terms of how, or if, perhaps better, a specific form of attention is under construction, as we might say, through these new kinds of computational technologies, through various pressures. Of course, there is the pressure that comes from capitalism, the requirement to commodify, the desire of Silicon Valley companies to continue to build on their advertising-based model of organization. But I think also in terms of a sense of how one comports oneself within a digital age, and how one is able to deal with and understand a world which is deeply infused with various forms of digital technology, various forms of data that surround us. And again, we could point towards, for example, financialization itself, the construction of the self through various kinds of forms of calculative and data-centric forms, and the somewhat difficult capacities that are required, perhaps above and beyond those of the human subject, unreconstructed. And so the turn to various forms of augmentation or exosomatizations that can stand in for or assist with these processes. So I just want to just show you a few slides really to kind of capture really some sense of the difference or how attention may be understood to be differently deployed. So here's a very famous and quite wonderful photograph of people wishing to capture the moment of Hillary Clinton in a rally in Orlando. And of course, the interesting thing about it is everyone's looking away from her in order to look at her, because they're mediating their attention, as it were. They're focusing their attention through a mediating technical device. Another nice example is, of course, the craze of Pokemon Go, and the way in which Pokemon Go, as an augmented reality application, created the potential for distraction, affecting the attentional state. And the seemingly unrequired sign that you wouldn't Pokemon and drive, but actually there were numerous examples of people falling off cliffs and crashing cars and all sorts of strange things happening, as people felt the captivating drive of the mobile device, combined with a kind of interesting what we might think of as a kind of gamification of the user interface in particular ways. Another nice example from Britain here of a driver who delivers shopping, having relied or over relied on the satellite navigation system in his van. And of course, there are lots of examples of this where one allows the focus on where one is going, the attention, as it were, to be delegated to a particular kind of technical device. Or perhaps you might wish to think of it in a different way, that in some sense the attentional capacity is prescribed back onto the driver, so that when you're told to turn down a particular road, your attention is not so much on where you're going, but on what you're being told, on that kind of mediating event again. This is another very famous example, so Joshua Brown, whose attention was elsewhere because no longer having more thinking, that he no longer had to pay attention to the motorway that he was on by using the autopilot, which would pay attention to the road for him. He instead watched Harry Potter on his computer. And of course, these auto-driving systems are still in an early phase of development, but nonetheless, people are, you merely need to look at YouTube. There's hundreds of videos of people using these kinds of autopilot systems and jumping into the back of the car and allowing the car to pay attention, as it were, to the road whilst they can do other things. Of course, in this case, the attention of the autopilot was distracted by a white van, actually, and the result was that the car crashed, which raises some interesting questions about how one delegates attention to these technical devices, as well as an interesting question about the capacity for these systems to pay attention, as it were, without the oversight of the human. Of course, we live in these kind of complex information environments. We don't all drive, I don't think, I hope not, maybe not, A320 every day. But this doesn't look particularly complex to us anymore, which is rather interesting. These kinds of dashboards, these kind of informational devices are becoming much more a part of our everyday life. Organizations increasing work through dashboards, even the way in which we track our everyday activities, whether that be through exercise or through people reading our articles online, our blog, and so on and so forth. These kinds of interfaces are becoming increasingly pronounced. And of course, I trust that nobody here would have a desktop that looks like this, but the kind of informational overload is obviously another issue with how one pays attention and the requirement for mediating processes to allow us to get a grasp on or to be able to focus and pay attention on particular things. So of course there are lots of these kinds of systems whereby attention can be managed through various computational devices. We might want to make a link here, which I won't develop, but it's certainly interesting to think about in terms of the relationship between wealth and attention. I think increasingly attention will be a commodity that's purchasable as a technology form, and you know, of course, here is a day trader, and these systems are of course not cheap. But these mediations of very complex information environments allow, mediate the attention, in some sense, augment attention, or you may argue there is a sort of exo-somatization of attention that's going on here. And these systems obviously get more and more complicated, and we get these kind of crazy eight-screen day trading systems. And of course, as the markets increase in complexity, as data increases in complexity, so there is seemingly a need for more and more screens to manage more and more information. And of course, that's where augmented reality has come in, and the potential here for unlimited screens. You can see here, this is an example from HoloLens, which allows screens to float around you, so you have unlimited screens and limited data. And of course, you know, the question of focus, the question of attention, the question of mediation is going to continue to come forward here. HoloLens is still in development, still in an early phase. And it is interesting that they nearly reproduce the desktop form in this augmented reality. But it's worth looking at some of these systems, I think, to see how the latest conceptions of how one manages a complex information environment takes place. So there's some wonderful videos from Meta, for example, that have these kind of virtual desktops and virtual objects that they can manipulate using these augmented reality systems. And of course, the kind of potential for various forms of computational systems, or even the kind of subset of the big multi-billion pound Silicon Valley companies, such as Google, rises up as a kind of question. There was an article very recently in The Guardian, I'm sure you saw, which documented how Google Instant Search has become a streaming system, essentially, which tries to present a sort of stream of searches ahead of one, as it were, and in some senses enable you to focus and pay attention by outsourcing or augmenting the capacity to curate, the capacity to filter. And one of the famous quotes from Google is, of course, they want to become the third half of your brain. Don't think the math is adding up there, but nonetheless, this notion that one would have this augmented capacity is a big driver of many parts of the kind of political economy of Silicon Valley. So what I would like to do, really, after showing those examples, is start to think about some concepts that I'm working with in relation to question of tension, questions of existentialization, but also in terms more generally of knowledge, the structuring of knowledge, the production of a certain kinds of formation that allow stabilizations of knowledge and practices. So one thing that strikes me is that in some senses, I think it's perhaps helpful to think about this in terms of infrastructures. Certainly in my new work, I'm working and thinking about infrastructures as particular kinds of instantiations, particular kinds of formations, particular kinds of constitutive technologies or techniques. And so I've been thinking about this notion of infrasomatizations as opposed to exosomatizations or endosomatizations. And really that's because the notion of infrasomatizations allows one to think about the fusion, essentially, of what we might call the endosomatic capacities and exosomatic techniques into particular kinds of infrastructural technologies, particularly that are hidden and that are obscured in some sense, that are, let's say, delightful, that are fluid in their interaction with us. And the idea really is to kind of drill down a bit into the question of infrastructure and knowledge more generally in my work, but actually, in particular here, to think about how this concept might help us think about the specific instance of attentional exosomatization, and particularly around this question of paying attention. So of course, I'm sure you're very familiar with the notion of exosomatic and endosomatic, so I won't review this, but it's useful nonetheless if you've not come across the notions before. So essentially, endosomatic instruments are these notions of legs, claws, and so on and so forth, given to an organism by birth. And exosomatic are a kind of techniques external to the body, and in some sense, the claim is anyway, that in some sense, that they offer an evolutionary alternative to that of the organism. So there can be a kind of acceleration of some form of evolution. So by infrasomatization, I want to rather think about the non-instrument form of exosomatization. So here I'm thinking of really the way in which certain kinds of externalization are actually manifest as conditions of possibility, are actually manifest in an infrastructural sense, and in an infrastructural sense that give the capacity for forming certain kinds of institutions, certain kinds of organization structure. And really I'm working towards a concept that can, and a set of concepts really, that can help think about the way in which these externalizations are structured in such a way as to produce these kinds of capacities for knowledge production, knowledge dissemination, and knowledge places more generally, actually. So places kind of important in the way in which I'm thinking about these questions today. So I'm going to review this very quickly. As I say, this is kind of tentative, but one thing that the notion of infrasomatization, I think, does, which is kind of useful, is it allows us to think about a specific, perhaps, instance of augmentation and automation that is located in a specific way, a specific infrastructural way, particularly in terms of what we might call scale technologies. And it allows us also to think about the way in which what we might think of as a kind of technological a priori is structured and allows different kinds of capacity to be built upon them. Now, I think this is kind of helpful because it also allows us to think about the contestations of these infrastructures, and of course, I'm particularly interested in these kind of infrastructures at the moment. So I've been developing the notion of tactical infrasomatizations as well. So thinking about how one can intervene at particular points, of course, Andrew Feinberg is useful here, thinking about what he calls intervention points, but also Gerd Vink and Ned Rossiter, etc., and the media, tactical media literature is, I think, very interesting for raising these kinds of questions. And perhaps this is interesting because these kinds of infra-somatizations are deployed in some sense invisibly. They're deployed behind the backs of actors in many cases. One doesn't always have a part to play in decisions over the deployment of these kinds of technologies. They do need to be brought forward. And here, of course, I'm gesturing to the wider work in software studies, etc. But really, it's this question of how one works with these contestations, right? One way, of course, is to make the invisible visible. But also, I'm thinking in terms of the interesting idea Alan New has been deploying in terms of critical infrastructure studies. So I'll kind of point to that literature as well. So Feinberg, for example, argues that the moment of design could be a really important intervention point here for these kinds of infrastructural issues. But really, it's around a kind of contestation at a very, I think, important point whereby institutions are really deploying certain kinds of technologies, what we're here calling infrasomatized technologies, often without being fully cognizant of what they are and the way in which they complement or contest certain kinds of structure, existing structure. So we might think of NGOs and public sector organizations and universities deploying various forms of accounting systems, but still from the private sector, perhaps certain kinds of market assumptions that are made in these systems that are slightly adapted for a different case, but nonetheless focus in this sense attention on particular aspects. So for example, in my university, there is an increasing sense of a certain kind of accounting of teaching, a certain kind of pre-structuring, as it were, of how one thinks about what's often called the teaching unit. And partly this is a response from new financial systems of control that have been imported, particularly at my university, a company called Agresso, which has a great and somewhat frightening name. But nonetheless, these systems, these infrastructures actually have interesting effects on knowledge formations, I would claim. So, infrastructure, of course, if you're not familiar, is usually considered the kind of basic physical and organizational structures and facilitates. So people often think of buildings and roads and power supplies and so on and so forth. And they're kind of needed for the kind of general operation of society or a company or so on and so forth. One has to build these kind of big infrastructures. And of course, interestingly, Trump's big claim to be elected was that he would be investing huge quantities of money in the American infrastructure of the country. Parks has nicely quoting engineers that infrastructure is stuff you can kick. That's useful as far as it goes. Of course, it's much harder to kick software, much harder to kick these kind of code-based deployments. Both, of course, you can continue to kick the servers, but whether that kicks the software, I'm not sure. But anyway, this aspect of infrastructure is interesting because of the kind of duress, and I would like to keep that kind of materiality that it carries with it when we start thinking about these infrasomatizations in relation to attention. So often these are latent technologies, they're backgrounded, they're hidden, they're often constructed in particular ways, often very modular, and of course built with various normative structures embedded within them, which have to be unpicked and considered. But nonetheless, often deployed quite problematically. As I say, my university didn't even raise the question of whether a private sector accounting system would be appropriate internally for a university, which is obviously a different kind of sense of what is important. Infrastructure too gestures to a kind of giganticism and a kind of notion of the fundamental technologies. And of course, infrastructure doesn't necessarily have to have those. I'm trying to kind of capture this kind of sense that infrastructure gives and why I think infrasomatization might be a useful way of talking about these kinds of particularly data infrastructures or what we might think of as computational materiality. So we see these deployed widely. Talked a little bit about financialization, and financialization, of course, is heavily dependent on these kinds of structures, but also datification more generally, and the kind of deployment of various forms of computation in everyday life, and the requirement for these infrastructures to allow us to deal with data, to deal with what seems like an ephemeral form, to deal with what might seem like a lack of concreteness when we think of various forms of a deployment that is used today, so we talk about cloud streams, files, and flows, and so on and so forth. And infrastructure is quite an interesting notion as well, because it does allow us to bring back in a lot of the kind of stuff that's been pursued in some of the more interesting work in infrastructure studies, and connecting up quite literally the question of cables and wires, satellites and receivers, chips and boards, and so forth. It's a and key issue. So just again to reiterate, the reason why I think this infrastructural question, this infrasanitization as a concept might be helpful, is because question of institutions is not in place, it requires certain kinds of infrastructure to be put in place. And in my new work around the university, for example, the question of infrastructures is always a question. It's not something that can be set aside. And when one thinks about the specific epistemic communities, the knowledge formations around that, one gets a sense of how important these kinds of structures are. Okay. So what I'm going to do is move on a little bit now to think about the specific question of attentional technologies. So I'm going to just flip to the attention slides, just being aware of the limitations of time. So if we think about attention, then the kind of problematic of attention, the capacity of attention, it's certainly noticeable that the human capacity of attention in relation to computational devices seems to leave something to be desired. Our capacity to attend to things, our capacity to pay attention, our capacity to focus is very dependent on many different factors, and the production of attention, the production of the capacity of attention has been a problematic, although not always thought of in terms of attention, I might add, but nonetheless a kind of problematic of how one attends to things. And of course that raises lots of interesting questions in and of itself. We might note that the specific form of attention as attention is a product of modernity and modern psychology, and of course empirical psychology. And this is, of course, related to the requirement that the subject of modernity had a need to pay attention in perhaps a different way than had previously been expected. And with the requirement to work in factories, to deal with quite complex machinery, complex assemblages of machines, complex forms of production, the way in which attention was focused became hugely critical. You wouldn't want your workers to be paying attention elsewhere. You'd want them to focus on the machine, to be understanding of the requirement for a certain form of attention, certain mode of attention, as it were, a certain capacity of attention directed in a particular way. And of course, more generally, one thinks of the notion of how one pays attention to the scientific endeavor or the requirements of a particular organization and so on and so forth. So attention becomes, as it were, subject to scientific investigation and the construction of it as a kind of problematic, and the development of mechanisms of control and quantification, a sort of Taylorism of attention, as it were, is still an ongoing issue. And of course, in the contemporary age, attention itself becomes deployed in some sense as a question of lack. The fact that the human capacity for attention is not possible to be developed endosomatically, as we might think, but actually requires some kind of exosomatized technology that can augment or support or provide a certain kind of prescriptive ability to manage the mediation of whether that be a complex information environment or, much more likely, a heavily commoditized environment. So the capacity to pay attention requires certain kinds of infrastructure investment in a digital age, these kinds of knowledge infrastructurizations, as I'm calling them, create a certain space of knowledge, a certain creation of a possibility for what we might call a computational attention or an augmented attention. And again, this is both at a psychic and at a social level. One way of thinking about this is that this is a kind of form of attentional proletarianization. Attention is, shall we say, differently proletarianized. As I previously referred to, I think this will be an aspect of wealth, but nonetheless, the question of the excess somatization of attention, I think, is a contemporary issue and neatly connects to these new consumer products that are developed, like Google Assistant, Apple Siri, machine learning, and all of these new kinds of systems that are constantly nudging us, constantly prompting us to pay attention, to look at this, to eat more fruit, to exercise more, and so on and so forth. There is a large amount of new work that's taking place in computer science around this issue. I do recommend you go and have a look at some of this stuff. Wonderfully, computer science places a lot of this material in the public sphere, so you can go and have a look at some of it on YouTube, etc. And the question of gaze tracking, mind reading machines, computational attention, and so on and so forth are all terms of the art that are used within these fields, and essentially are a new intensification around excess somatization of attention in and of itself. So there's this question of capturing attention, there is this question of augmenting attention, there is a question of deployment of attention, and we're very much in a moment where processes of what we might call de-attentioning and re-attentioning is taking place. There are lots of experiments around these new infrastructural forms. And of course, many of these experiments are located at the level of the interface. Lots of experiments around algorithmic interfaces, interfaces that shift in real time in response to our attention or to structure our attention, just-in-time informational dashboards and surfaces. And this notion of pre-framing as well. Google very much has this notion that it has half a second to capture your attention. And the idea really is to place before your eyes the answer before you have an ability to contest it or to think other. So the pre-framing is hugely important in this sense. So we've seen these kind of assemblages, and of course, you know, to reiterate, these are scale technologies, right? Although we experience them at a micro level on our devices, they're actually very large infrastructure. So they are, as I've called them, infra-somatizations. For example, Apple Siri requires massive computational capacity. Most of the complex work of thinking, as it were, and providing information is offloaded via the network. It doesn't sit in your device, and of course, the same with the other kinds of systems. Now, of course, chips get faster, users are getting faster, and so on and so forth, and some of this currently offloaded technology moves back slowly, but the infrastructures, I think, are there to stay and are hugely important in relation to these new deployments of various forms of knowledge structures, which we call them. So, noticing I haven't got much time left, what I want to do is...
You should conclude the DVD.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What I'm going to do is very quickly just demonstrate some of the ways we've been thinking about these things. So if you forgive me shooting through my slides. Really, what I want to do is to show you, and this you'll be very familiar with, but the way in which one approach to thinking about structuring attention in a particular way. It's this card form. This is a screen that I talk about at the beginning of my talk. And really the idea is one moves through material in a particular way, so that attention is focused on a particular digital object, shall we call it, at a particular moment, and that you can go through time. Now the advantage to the system is the structuring of attention, the simplification of attention, the temporal construction of attention, and also it allows the control of this attentional form, right? Because the company or the algorithm that controls the flow of these streams, in some senses, controls the focus of attention to which one plays. And very quickly, just to link back really to the issues raised by this conference and, of course, the work of Erie. We've been thinking about some of the ways in which the notion of contesting these attentional forms, these streaming forms, is possible through contributory annotations or the ability to write back into the stream or to contest the stream or to, in some sense, decode the stream. A lot of this work will be put on the web after this talk, so you can Google if you're wanting to look at these slides later. Thank you.